We all know why Africa has been growing without creating jobs, due to its reliance on traditional goods and less value-added primary commodities. Then comes industrialization to help us transform and achieve inclusive growth, like we experienced with East Asia. Today, you have many countries within the region that have adopted a new industry policy, as if we've forgotten the lessons from past policy failures. Besides, the challenges to attain industrialization may be more daunting than before. Hence, the purpose of this paper is to look at the experiences with industrial policy in some of the sub-Saharan African countries in order to draw practical lessons for the region. We start looking at the relationship between industrialization, inclusive growth, and structural transformation. Looking at this table, table one presents a production structure, as you can see, between on selected countries between two groups that we've presented there. Structural transformation has taken place in China and to a lesser extent India, but weak in sub-Saharan Africa. You look at manufacturing, the share of manufacturing as a percentage of GDP that has increased significantly in China and to a lesser extent India, but has reduced in sub-Saharan Africa. excuse me. Although the region has experienced rapid GDP growth rate per capita since 2005, if you look there, sub-Saharan African region since 2005, but that was not driven by increase in the share of manufacturing as a percentage of GDP. Looking at that rapid growth, it was driven by Nigeria. Of course, that tells you it's mainly driven by mineral sector. excuse me. You look at figure two, it tells you, consistent with what we've seen in figure one, that excess labor was absorbed in less productive activities such as agriculture and the informal sector. Looking at specific countries, Uganda, for example, remains largely agricultural. More than half of all jobs are in the agricultural sector. The same applies to Ghana. In South Africa, like Mauritius, employment gains have been made in the services sector, but you and I know that the services sector does not create a large number of jobs, and these jobs are highly skilled in a situation where you have a number of unemployed, mainly unskilled, an unfortunate mismatch. And that's what we're presenting, what we're saying here. So the question then is, what are the reasons for low pace of industrialization in the region? One is the region's inability to build technological capacity. Technological change and the innovation remain central in the literature on industrialization. Drawing from East Asian experience, we know that technology diffusion or technology progress and its diffusion, it's very critical for promoting industrialization. And what factors? We have two factors that mainly drives that. One is investment in domestic investment in absorptive capacities, and foreign direct investment through multinational enterprises. Looking at table one, evidence from table one and table three and figure three show that there's widened technological gap amongst sub-Saharan African countries as a result of insignificant growth in research and development expenditure. The region has experienced a decline in scientific publishing as well as in the number of patents granted. Also, due to the low level of human capital relevant to industry and the significant outflow of skilled labor, which we call brain drain. So you produce skills that are not required by the industrialist. or by industries. In examining the policy interventions in East Asia, in East Asian governments to advance technological capabilities, one common basic element is the creation of human capital. Although some countries are making noticeable efforts, what is important is that the government still drives research and development funding, which is not sustainable going forward. Another factor, critical factor, is that the region has managed to attract FDI, but the problem is that that's still in traditional sectors or primary commodities, not in manufacturing, which then undermine the role played by FDI through multinational enterprises. The second reason for low pace of industrialization in the region is you could trace that from different industrialization strategies that have been adopted in the past. Looking at that table, we try to capture a few of those. What is very important to note is that one is that our SMMEs in the region are locked into repetitive routines of learning by doing, and disconnected from both local and global knowledge flow. According to Khan, for example, Khan 2013, even if you if you acquire the machines and have workers and the managers who have the formal knowledge that is required for the use of the technology, you may still not be able to engage in competitive production if there were no organizational capabilities. That is tacit knowledge that the organization acquires through learning by doing and experimentation. When infant industries fail to graduate into productive enterprise despite decades of doing financed by different government interventions, it is almost because there was a failure in organizational learning. Another factor, critical factor, is access to finance, which has been talked by different people here, presenters. Another major constraint is the monopolistic pricing of privately owned key intermediate inputs into the manufacturing sector. Import parity pricing markups are often a higher order of magnitude, meaning that tariff reduction might have a limited impact on price moderation. Despite having generally low industrial tariffs, most countries apply high tariff. If you look at that, you see that the tariff peak is very high, high tariff peaks from the table, to protect local production and infant industries from import competition. And what is that telling you? It's telling you that we're not yet the burden we, the issue of trade liberalization, which we rushed into in order to align ourselves to a requirement by during our structural adjustment program, we haven't come out of that kind of burden. Similarly, industrial efforts are pursued in some countries through the utilization of export taxes in order to discourage the export of raw materials and foster local processing. That's what we're getting, we're finding from our studies. But like tariff, export taxes could be prohibited under the EPAs being negotiated with the EU, which is the is going ongoing. It is also observed that very few countries apply non-tariff barriers such as anti-dumping, countervailing, and safeguards, except for South Africa and Botswana. Yet, under the current international trade rules, countries cannot use tariff instruments against their trading partners. Even when they are threatened by cheap imports. So these instruments very important, but you find out that many countries in the region they don't apply that. Another commonly observed pattern in the priority accorded to export-led growth and hence to instruments that encourage production for foreign markets, the export processing zones. These EPZs are characterized by a wide range of incentives and concessions, yet there is a significant controversy over their effectiveness. Another reason for low pace of industrialization in the region is weak institutions governing the design and implementation of industrial policies. You need political leadership at the top, as well as coordination across ministries and departments. Transparency of the industrial policy making process in order to check rent seeking behavior. Systematic representation of the private sector, very critical, but it seems that some of SAA's many industrial policies pursued since independence has not resolved the above underlying issues. Also important to note is institutional failures, particularly in training and the funding, as well as a poor monitoring and evaluation system, which are still lacking. We try to capture major and emerging challenges of SAA's industrialization under four questions. The first one on regional integration, which I don't want to discuss further because there's been a lot of discussion on that, why it's important. The second one is on can African industrialization survive without some smart protectionism? Because of time constraints, I don't want to go in deep into that, but it's given, you can see that from my paper. But the answer is no, you cannot do without a smart protection. In other words, you have, and that has been alluded in some of the discussions or presentation this morning, so you have importers, exporters that are importing inputs. So you want to protect them in order to enable them to become competitive out there. So without protecting these exporters, it becomes very difficult for them to be able to compete out there, but there are more to that. You have to be smart. The third question, should Africa continue with incentive structure given to foreign investors at the expense of local firms? Again, the answer is no, but you find details in the paper. And how beneficial is Chinese-Africa partnership? Ensure that you monitor that relationship. It's very important for the region to transform, I mean the relationship, but you have to monitor that to make sure that you're making, you're getting what you've bargained for. I would like to conclude on this note. First, is that the question with implications for policy making include how to link science, technology, and innovation to poverty reduction, job creation, and sustainable livelihood. How to build capacity and competencies to innovate, and how to expand knowledge. The outcome of this policy decision will determine the type of innovation that will take place in the region. The second one is that economies of scale remains critical. There's so many negotiations going on to the extent that some of the countries are negotiating with developed countries at the expense of their neighbors, and no one is monitoring these negotiations, which can hamper Africa economic integration. Also, you talk of industrial policy which hasn't been harmonized to enable that monitoring. The third point is in order to exploit economies of specialization and stimulate knowledge spillovers, efforts are needed to integrate firms and agreements and the segments of businesses community through supplier development programs, incentives for technology transfer, encouragement of joint ventures, among others. Finally, there is need for complementarity between the government's consistently proactive industrial policies and the coherent and equally proactive policies in support of the development of local firms' capabilities. And in that, I want to note the issue of tripartite, which will be very important because the previous presenters also mentioned that the need for a tripartite between institutions, I mean academic institutions, government, and the businesses, in order to be able to generate skills needed in industries going forward, for that will enable us to transform. Thank you.